Good evening, and welcome to the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen of the City of New York. I am Karen Taylor, Program Director for the General Society. This program is supported in part by public funds from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs in partnership with the City Council. I would also like to express our thanks to Thomas Donahue, who is our window curator, and he has yet again produced a wonderful window display, and I encourage you all to look at it tonight when you leave, if you didn't see it when you arrived this evening. I also want to express our great appreciation to co-curator of the Artisan Lecture Series, Rhett Butler, for his suggestion of tonight's speaker. The General Society was founded in 1785 by 22 artisans. Artisans who represented different trades, including carpenters, silversmiths, blacksmiths, tailors, and many more. Our Artisan Lecture Series pays tribute to our original founding of these 22 artisans. Today, our 234-year-old organization continues to serve the people of the City of New York through our educational and cultural programs. These include the library, of which you're in this evening, our John M. Mossman Lock Collection, and you're very welcome to look at that after the program tonight, our tuition-free Mechanics Institute, and of course, our lecture series. Tonight's lecture is part of a tradition of presenting, of the General Society presenting lectures for nearly 200 years. You will also find additional information on the General Society on the blue and white postcard on the front table. Tonight, we are absolutely delighted to be able to showcase the work of atelier, metalworker, and silversmith Berthold Hoffmann from Hoffmann Metal Vessels. And Berthold has come over especially from Germany to speak here tonight and also to have his work showcased at E.R. Butler & Co. in Soho. Berthold Hoffmann studied techniques of metalworking with additional training at the Academy of Fine Arts in Nuremberg, Germany, in the gold and silversmith department. There he developed his artistic idiom of handcrafted objects of everyday culture made of cast iron and sterling silver, created in a personal design language, a language that he will talk about tonight. His work has won multiple awards. It is now a huge pleasure to introduce to you Berthold Hoffmann.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm glad to be here tonight to give you an insight into my life and work. Thanks to the General Society for inviting me to be part of the Artisan Lecture Series 2019. And to Rhett Butler, who made the first contact between the General Society and me. Last November, I took part at the Philadelphia Museum of Art Craft Show as German guest artist for the third time. Rhett Butler stopped at my booth and we discussed the possibility of an exhibition of my objects at his showroom in Manhattan and doing a lecture about my work at the General Society. I confirmed to do this and now I'm here tonight. It's easy. Sometimes it's very easy. What makes my work different from that of other metal craftsmen and silversmiths is the use of the material cast iron in a handcrafted way. I like this material because of its heaviness and the powerful expression of the finished objects. Nobody is born as a metal craftsman, so you might want to hear something about my way to this craft. My father was a passionate amateur painter, and he liked to go out for nature studies, sketches, and watercolors, and often he took me with him, for example, on the bicycle from my childhood on. The little guy in front, that's me. Yeah. We also went together to exhibitions and museums. Later, I did this on my own, and so I had a basic input of many kinds of art at the end of my high school in 1975. I had been sketching and painting by myself too, but without a real concept. To get a professional training in art, I had in mind to study art at an art school. Because of being bored of all the theoretical learning in school, I decided to start an apprenticeship in metalcraft first. And the company I worked with was specialized on architectural works like doors and lightings, especially made of brass. That was the first time I came in contact with metal in a professional way, and I like to work with the different materials like brass, copper, and steel, and learned a lot about the different techniques of metal crafting. After the apprenticeship, I visited several art schools in Germany and came across the Academy of Fine Arts in Nuremberg in 1979, where I met my later teacher, Erhard Hössle, professor at the Department of Gold and Silversmithing. What's that? Oh, something does not work with the technique. Okay, someone will help me in a moment. Impressed by his huge metal objects, functional cookware and tableware with an extraordinary design, I decided to become a student. Until then, I had never thought of producing functional cookware and tableware by hand, but I started to learn that this is a part of human culture too. This work you see on the image is work of my professor. This was the first impression I get about his work. Lots of big silver pots, cups, candlesticks in front with on steel tablets and something like this. I had never seen such things before, and it impressed me very much, and I decided to become a student. In order to be trained in the technique of silversmithing, I started with simple forms, plates, and bolts of brass with a ring soldered to the top to make it look more solid, and with tinned surface to make it usable for food. There you see the ring, because it looks more solid if you had only the thin wall of the silver plate. I use normally material 1.2 millimeter. And it would not look solid like it does this way. And also, okay, the tin surface is oxide. There's oxide on the surface because this work is more than 40 years old, and I didn't carry it very careful. The next step was to add functional details like handles to a simple bowl. So this was the first bowl. I add a functional detail like the handles. Okay, at that time it was okay, but from my nowadays view, I think it does not look very elegant. This bowl is forged from a disc of brass, and the handles casted of brass and fixed by soldering. I also started to do my first cast iron objects, for example, this simple bowl with two handles forged of steel edit after casting. I drilled the cast iron, and then I could move the handle in the cast iron, and it soldered. Considering the possibilities the technique of casting offers to me in contrast to silversmithing, the consequence was to make objects casted all in one piece, for example, this bowl with handles. So I think, you see, it looks much more elegant now, and I think it's for me, it makes sense if I do a casted object, it is ready, the form is ready after I have casted it. What I learned from this was to see the main difference between the technique of silversmithing and the technique of casting. Silver objects are mostly made by adding several diverse parts together, especially in the field of tableware, where you need functional details. Cast iron objects could be formed and cast in one piece, and I could create fine organic shapes, like you see it at this form, because I like it very much, how this moves, the handle moves into the body. I went on with different kind of works. For example, the next two objects, the bowl and the pot with flexible handles and soldered feet. The body is done of two parts, a concave disc and an L-shaped hoop soldered together. Oh. The feet are soldered to the bottom of the bowl. At the top, there is a ring and four applications to keep the handles in a flexible way. Okay. This is the ring to make the material look more solid. These are the applications, and then I edit them together in a flexible way so the handle can move up and down. A few years later, with more experience, I made this variation of sterling silver. The bodies of the objects are made on a spinning machine and the surface is polished. It looks much more elegant than the form I did of brass, but I have learned during the years, I have learned much new techniques and to get better forms. Here you see the detail of the handles and how it added together with the body of the pot. All this time, we were a group of students in the course of gold and silversmithing, young and passionate, working all day and making a lot of different kind of cook and tableware. It was an extraordinary time working in this atmosphere of creativity. We started to make cooking equipment with a heater of its own, and my interpretation was a teppanyaki grill. The base is a square plate with four diagonal struts at the bottom to have enough distance for the heat protection of the table, and on the top to have enough distance to the grill plate to make the heater work well. The grill plate sits on the top of the struts. Beside its function, for me, it is a minimalistic sculpture too. The form is very simple, but it has a powerful expression. The heater is made of brass, a lot of diverse parts soldered together. We analyzed different kinds of heaters we had found in outdoor or houseware stores, and a friend of mine had inspired me to use the following technique for the teppanyaki grill I had created. Here you see with the grill plate on the top. Here the burner is on work. Okay, This is a principle. This is a principle how a heater is working. The burner has two chambers in the middle and outside. They are connected because if you fill in the denatured alcohol, it can move in the outer chamber. You light the alcohol in the middle. This warms up the heater, and after and at around 80 degrees Celsius, the alcohol changes from fluid into gas. The gas comes out of the outer chamber through the small holes you can see here on these pictures. And so it has much power to heat up the grill plate. For the regulation of the heat, you use lids with a ring. For example, this situation, the power is working with full, the heater is working with full power. This is to, so it works with less power, and so you can close the heater. A group of friends have a lot of my cookware and had a big meal together. This guy behind is working with the Tisch grill, and all the friends are looking very hungry and waiting to get ready. Also, this situation was at the Museum of Art and Craft in Hamburg during the Christmas craft show, and we were feeding two times a day the visitors of the museum working with this teppanyaki grill. The idea behind this object was, in former times or in tribal or primitive cultures, the fireplace was the center of the hut and people came around the fireplace to warm up or have meal together. I wanted to do a contemporary interpretation of the theme. With this object, you can bring fire, a central element, on your table. You can use it inside your house or in your garden, sit around this object and prepare your meal together. It is a slow and communicative way of having meal. For example, you can do meat, vegetables or fish on this grill, but food has to be cut into small slices to get well done. Another work I did during my study was this grill. It is composed of three parts: the grill, the fireplace, and the stand. To regulate the heat, you can move the fireplace up and down, and it fixes by its own weight, because it is hanging only on one leg of the stand. The fireplace and the grill sticks and can be moved from it easily. You can fold up the stand. If you want to grill outdoor, it is easy to take it with you in the car, and you don't need much space to store it inside your house in winter. This was my first prize-winning object in 1987. It was awarded with the Bavarian State Award for Young Designer. I discovered the construction of the stand in combination with a big pot in a museum of historical culture in Turkey, and found out later that it was a typical object in ancient times in the Mediterranean area, also in Northern Africa, used for cooking during traveling. I had been waiting for the right moment to use it for my own design. These years of studying in a creative atmosphere and free from regulations were the perfect time to build a fundament for a career as self-employed craftsman. My special thanks goes to my professor, Erhard Hössle, who was in close cooperation with us students all the time. In 1985, I established my own workshop in Nuremberg, Germany, because my years of studying came to an end. I called it Atelier Bertolt Hoffmann to signify that it is an artistic workplace. I found this place in an announcement in our local newspaper, and from the first day on, it has been the perfect place for working and living for me. Here you get some impressions of my workplace. This is the street view of the townhouse where we live. And in the backyard, you find my workshop. This is a typical situation in our town until the 70s of the 20th century. You could find small manufacturers or traders for every kind of mechanical equipment in these backyard houses. But this tradition died in the 80s, and these workshops changed into apartments and lofts. Today, it is an extraordinary situation to have this kind of workplace. After more than 30 years of working at this place, my neighbors are watching with interest what I am doing, even if it is sometimes not easy for them to accept some of those special noises that are generated during my work. Also, this is my horizontal planning machine. Later you will see it in work. Okay, this is a look in my studio. When I'm working, I create all the time a chaotic structure. I don't know how, but it happens by itself. Okay, this hammer and a lot of hammers in the backyard, but I think in every day's work I need only 8 to 10. But it looks very impressive. It makes much impressive if I have guests in my studio and they're looking, oh, this man has 70 hammers. Oh, what a great silversmith he must be. Yeah? Okay, my working table. Okay, this is a very old drilling machine. Okay, because when I established my studio, I was a student and I had not much money, but at that time we had, because a lot of manufacturers break, and we could buy machines very cheap. And also these old machines are out of order, but they're solid and simple and they will work for another 200 years or more. And I like it because of the shape. Today you have only boxes, and inside the box happens a lot of things, but you cannot see how the machine is working. This is my turning. Oh God, sorry. My Turing lathe. Yeah. This is the place where I clean the cast, or I do the cast iron work. And as you see, a lot of work is waiting for me. Okay, this is me in the protection helmet, and within the air filter, bringing fresh air into the helmet. Being educated and working with brass helped me at the beginning of my independence to make my living with works for public rooms. For example, I show you one project. The Nuremberg Opera was restored between 1995 and 1998 in cooperation with the architect responsible for the project. I developed several objects of interior design. In the porch of the opera, there are big octagonal chandeliers made of brass, around 1 meter high and covered with gray color. In the passage, you find 3 octagonal chandeliers made of polished brass. Inside the auditorium, you find these lamps on the front side of the balconies with 5, 4, and 3 arms. Every arm is covered with a leaf. For the bar, I had to create several table supports. They are made of solid square brass sticks. And it was a great work for me to do, and it's okay. Besides these public works, I went on to develop cook and tableware of cast iron and silver. The cast iron works became more and more important for me. On one hand, I liked the technique of the cooperation with. And the cooperation with the foundry very much. Compared with silversmithing, I get a result much faster, and from one mold, I can get a range of objects. On the other hand, these works attracted more and more public attention from design and interior magazines and in presentations at exhibitions and fairs. Before I go on to show you a range of my works, I will give you a quick overview of my process of designing. When I start a new object, I have a 3-dimensional image of this object in my mind. I hardly work with sketches, but start to make a model or a pattern. I want to do this teapot, and to get an idea how to do the form, I made this paper cut. And as I see the paper cut is okay, I make a cut of a sheet of brass. And it looks is similar to the paper cut. And here you see a form, the body of a teapot made of sterling silver, and here you see the form made of cast iron. What I want to show you is that the way to come to an object, it is the same if I do an object made of sterling silver or I do it in cast iron. Here you see, this is a model for a wine and water jug. And I started with a square wooden block and worked out the form of the jug. The pair of wine and water jugs is one has a square form, the other is circular. And this is a test made of copper. Here you see the form, the copper. This is the form you have to cut out of a sheet of copper, for example, or of a sheet of metal. And then, by this form, you can make a circular vessel or a square vessel. Here you see the ready wine and water jug made of sterling silver. I like to work with groups of objects because they get in a relationship together. This could be a couple, and they one look in this side, the other look in that side. But you can move the jug, so they will be in harmony or they will be divorced. And here you see how it works very well to fill in from this jug, for example, wine in a glass. Here you see the model of the teppanyaki grill. For this, I used a square plate of wood, one centimeter thick, with four small rectangular wooden plates fixed on the bottom and the top. They are fixed on the wooden plate. And then I go on with two component polyester filler, and I can do the organic forms. You see here. It allows me to get organic shapes between the base and the struts. After the filler has become hard, I grind the object by hand with abrasive paper until the surface gets plain. I have to do this several times to get a more or less perfect surface. The pattern of the fish frying pan is made of a sheet of copper, you see inside here, by cutting out an oval form of it and surrounding it with a conical hoop. And I also use two component polyester filer to get this pattern at the end. And with this, I can go to the foundry. To make the pattern for the casserole, I used the bucket for color because its form was perfect. I saw this in my studio, and then I saw it is the perfect form for this. And I cut it around here, and so I worked on with the polyester, and so I got the pattern for the foundry. In everyday life, we are surrounded by forms, and sometimes a given form can be the source of a new object. The further process is similar, covering the surface with two-component polyester filler, grinding by hand with abrasive paper to get a plain surface. To get a good result from the foundry, the patterns must have a minimum thickness of around 5 to 6 millimeters. I do this with the polyester. From the technical point of view, my way of pattern making is very traditional and untypical, but it gives me the chance to create one of a kind or small serious objects, and I can realize my ideas immediately whenever I want. For the realization of my objects, I had to find the right foundry partner who produces individual sand molds by hand. These are two guys of the foundry. And I like to be in contact to the foundry workers because they know what happens and not the man in the office. Yeah. For more than 20 years, I'm working together with the Neumarkter Eisengießerei Max Ginter. They store a range of my patterns and by order make the raw casting. To give you a simple idea of how to make a sand mold, I will show you the following profile sketches. You set a frame of steel on a plane and put the pattern, for example, a hemisphere, in the middle of the frame with the concave side down. The frame is filled with sand. By this, you get a sand mold of the outside of the hemisphere. You turn the frame around, set a second frame on the first frame, and fill it with sand again. This is the second frame, and this is filled with sand. By this, you get the inner form. You lift the second frame, and so you can take the pattern away. Now the frames are open, and this is the pattern, you can take it out. But by moving the pattern away, mostly these parts of the sand form get destroyed. And this means a lot of work after the casting. If you put the two frames together again, you have the free space for the iron. To fill the iron in, some tubes must be drilled in the upper sand form. The gatoring, and the venting. And by when you fill in the metal, it is filled up to this level. And so I will have this and this at the finished casting. Using this technique, every pattern has to be conical so that you are able to take it out without destroying the sand mold. Okay, but a little, it will happen that it will be a little bit destroyed. I will go on showing you some impressive images of the foundry. This man covers the sand form, or the surface of the sand form, with clay mixed with denatured alcohol, so you get a cover. Otherwise, the iron and the sand would be burned if one to the other. This man, he heat up this melting this pot. This pot is used to bring the fluid iron to the sand mold. Here they let out the fluid iron of the oven. This is the oven. Here runs out the fluid iron into a big pot. With this, the fluid iron is moved to the sand mold. Here you see how they fill in the iron in the sand molds. This is a raw casting of the casserole, and here you see the gatoring and the vendings. This man cuts the vendings away, and this is the situation I get my castings of the foundry. And here you see some parts. Okay, this is these parts come from the gatoring, and this comes from the broken sand form. And this means the work for me. I go on working on these objects with grinding machines until I get a uniform surface, because the bottom of the pans and pots are wavy, I plan them with my planing machine. You have seen before in the back before my workshop. Okay, maybe it is a little bit to understand if you are not so close to the subject. I will show later I will show a film, and then you will see very well how it works. By working with grinding machines, I get a different structure of the surface. To get a unique structure of the surface, all items are sandblasted before I finish them. I cover the surface with linseed oil and heat them up to 340 degrees Celsius, around 20 to 30 minutes, it depends on the mass of the object, in a special oven. They come out with a black surface, and they are pre-seasoned, and you can use them immediately. The cast iron cookware that you find on the market today is almost exclusively produced at high-tech plants. The tools you need are based upon computer-aided design constructions, and from the technical point of view, the result is nearly perfect. Because of the high costs of the tools, it is meant for mass production. For this reason, the design has to attract the masses. And this is one of the main differences between my work and the work you get by industry. A few years ago, a new standard was set in the technique of making sand molds. Negative sand molds can be printed directly from computer-aided design constructing. Using this technique, it is now possible to make a single object on the highest technical level. I used this technique for a part of my big fondue because of its special shape. It is very difficult to form from a pattern. These are the row casting did by the sand form you have seen before. This sand form was printed, and it looks very perfect. Here you see the finished part, and this is the reshow of the big fondue. But because if you form it by hand, and you want to remove the pattern out of the sand, it happens nearly every time that some of the small struts of sand break. Because if you form it in sand, and you bring it out of the sand form, here will be small struts of sand, and they are they can break very easy. By printing it, now I get a perfect sand mold. After giving you some basic technical information, I will go on showing you a range of my objects. These are cast iron bowls in a square form. I did a series of cast iron objects with this square form. And before I did this, I had studied bronze vessels, Chinese bronze vessels, very intensive. And there I found vessels in a square form. And I had in mind to find a personal interpretation of this form. Here you see a bigger square bowl. Okay, this measure is 16 centimeters. This is 28 centimeters. This is a pot, 24 centimeters and around 70 centimeters high. And this is a rectangular pot, 30 to 25 centimeters. And here you see it in work. This is another series. I want to do simple forms, also simple handles, but the handles must be very haptic, or you must have a solid grip if you carry the pot from the oven to the table. For this, the handles have this part, and you can keep it very secure. This is a pot, 25 centimeter. Cutter roll you had seen before, or you had seen the rock casting. And this is a fish frying pan, around 50 centimeter. A client of me had seen this casserole of cast iron, and then he ordered me to do this in massive sterling silver. It was a very fine job. But this does not happen too often. Okay, this idea came because I had turned round the lid of this casserole, and there I saw this lid turned round. It could be a nice bowl too. This is it's based on a raw casting, and this is a forged silver plate lying on this cast iron stand. This is, okay, you have seen, no, this is a smaller fondue set. This was awarded in 2016 with a German Design Award by the German Design Council. I wanted to do a much more normal fondue set because it's not so big as the other one that you have seen the Richaud before. But there are a lot of parts to must fit together. Okay, this fondue set was before, and it's a very big one. It's 43 centimeter, and this pot is 20 centimeter high and 20 centimeter diameter. Okay, the idea was not, in the beginning, was not to make a fondue, but the idea was to make an object. And I liked the combination of a plate with a three-dimensional body. And here you see how it looks like when it is in work. Also the burner. You see the blue flame under the pot. This is a tea set made of sterling silver on a tray of ebony. I like to make ensembles of several parts, and also it's a difference if you put the single teapot on your table, or if you put a whole set on your table. And also the tray is meant to keep the ensemble together. Here you see the single pieces, the sugar bowl with spoon, the creamer, and the teapot. And here also you can see what I tried to explain before, is silversmith's work is added of a lot of parts. I have this ring on the body, I have these parts to get the body and the handle together, I have made a lot of parts. And also this one is made of two parts. The lid needs this. This is another tea set based on a square form. I like to do similar forms in different material. This is a variation in cast iron. And this is a variation cast iron combined with sterling silver. The handle and the lid is forged of sterling silver. This is a group of mortars. And I like the combination of an octagonal, circular, a square form, because I think they have another meaning in this combination than I show only a single piece. This is a heater for a candle. This is a sketch for a stovetop. because I'm bored about having my big pots on a normal stove you can buy in a kitchen store, because they are very weak and I think they are not go together very well. And so I had an idea to make a solid a sketch for a solid top stove who has a good relation to my objects. But after 10 years, there is no technique inside. Okay, this is another variation of the square, octagonal, and circular form. These are three planters. So they look like with a nice tree, nice trees inside. Here you see, I show you some pictures of the situation. I have done a lot of exhibitions during all my working time. And here I show you some situations, how this can look at an exhibition. And here the show is over. Okay. I like to show my work in exhibitions because it's a fine situation to show the work in a museum or something like this. And I did several exhibitions in Germany, but on the other hand, I like it. I will say I like it more if clients buy some of my works and they use it in their everyday life, because I want to do objects for everyday life. Also, the silver objects are meant for everyday life, because I use also very thick silver plates, maybe 1 millimeter or 1.2 millimeter, because it's solid, you can use it every day, and if you hit it, it will not have it will be okay. It's not destroyed so easy. And so I like it very much if someone has ordered one of my pieces and I have sent it to him, and maybe 1 week later I get an email, oh, we had fine chicken or we had a fine meat in a pot, and this for me is maybe it's the same pleasure than showing the pieces in a museum show. Okay, thank you for listening. And now we can see the video about the production of a cast iron pan. This is a TV series who explain everyday's try to explain everyday's things, and so he is asking, why does a pen? No sound, please. No sound, please. And so he is asking, why does a Hoffmann pot costs around 500 euro? Is it? Okay, these are some optic gimmicks they like to do. Okay, this is me moving in my studio. Okay, the hammer. It's very they were also impressed by the hammer. And here I start to make the pattern from a sheet of copper. I can cut the disc with a hand cutting tool. Here this hoop I weld. And here I'm bringing on the surface the two-dimensional polyester filler. Oh, I think I'm on the way to the foundry. And here I have arrived. Here you see the iron frame, and he is putting my pattern in the middle of this iron. Okay, he turns the mold around. There is no sound because it's in German language, and I think it's better I explain a little bit by my own. He's putting the second frame on the first frame and is filling it with sand. This is for the gatoring. This is the raw cast iron they melt in the special oven. They use fresh iron and they use recycled iron, half and a half. Mm-hmm. Now they bring it up in the oven. They fill the oven is a big tube, and they fill the oven and fill in the iron and foundry coke in this tube from the top. Okay, he has worked very carefully, but maybe it comes because it was filmed. They do it not all the time. So, okay, he covers the surface with the clay and a denatured alcohol mixture. Yeah, it's a nice place, so much fire all over there. Yeah. He is opening the melting oven. And now they fill in the fluid iron into the sand mold. But they are doing a very hard job because it is every day they work in this hot surrounding, and it's also a very dusty situation. So here you see the raw casting, and they will destroy the sand. Every sand form after casting is destroyed, but the model will stay, and I can use it for several castings. They have a big sand blasting machine, and by this they clean the surface the first time. But after grinding, I give it or I sandblasted it again. This is the planning machine, but okay, the situation is at the foundry. And now I'm starting working. In the beginning, I did not use this protection clothes, and I was black when I came out in the evening of the workshop. But I saw this at the foundry, and then I know I must something do for my protection. Now he is sandblasting the pot to make the illegal structure. Here I brush the object with linseed oil, and now I bring it into the oven. After around 20 minutes, it comes out with a black surface. And this is a chef. He is testing the pan to see if it's not only beautiful, but if it's only working well, if it's also working well. And he tests stainless steel and aluminium and the cast iron pan. And by this infrared camera, you can see how the heat is spreading into the material. And with the cast iron, it's very regular. The steel is very bad. Okay, it's not only the infrared camera, it's only he's doing the cooking. Okay, because you cannot hear what he said, but I can tell you he said, this is the best, my pan is the best. You may believe or not. Okay, he's giving points on the three pens. Okay, I say my is the best. And okay, aluminium is not so bad, but the stainless steel pan is not, stainless steel is not an ideal material for cooking because it has a bad heat spreading. Have nothing in your house which you do not know to be useful or believe to be beautiful, William Morris said. Okay, thank you for listening.
question and answer, please wait to be passed the mic so we can record your questions and talk directly into the microphone. Thank you.
I could see all the effort that went into making a single pan and why there would be a good cost for that. But it also looks like you could have a 200-year warranty, or at least a lifetime warranty on these.
Longer.
What? Lifetime?
100 lives.
After lifetime.
100 lives. So you must, it's the best you buy it if you're young, because you have much use of this kind of work.
I have a question. When they're first made, do you need to season them?
Excuse me?
They need to be prepared?
No, they are by covering the surface with linseed oil and then burn the linseed oil. It is pre-seasoned and you can start.
Oh, wow.
But because the cast iron is porous, and if you use oil for broiling, and the oil moves into the pores, and it gets better and better as more often you use the cast iron pan. You clean it only with hot water, but mm-hmm. you cannot wash out the oil that sticks in the pores. And so if you use it regularly, after maybe half a year, it works perfect.
So it's pre-season. Thank you.
I'll give you the mic and then I'll take it.
For the printing of the mold that you illustrated in one of your pieces, is that done at the foundry or at another location?
No, this is a special company who is specialized on computer-aided design printing. Not only sand molds, they do also whatever you can do with three-dimensional printing today.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Hi, you were right. You have to buy it early. I got my Crusade cast iron 50 years ago, and I still have it. So I don't know if you were doing that 50 years ago. I was just wondering, are you doing any more public works? Like, your tables are so beautiful.
Okay, after I had established my studio, I had done a lot of public works, because at the Academy of Fine Arts there was also a professor for interior design, and we came in contact, and I got a lot of jobs by his contact. But I like to do these public works. But on the other hand, it's a little bit risky, because I can never give the guarantee I do not a mistake. And so if you make a mistake, you have and something happens to people who move through this public room, I never can pay a lawyer to make it comfortable for me. And so, I work very solid, and because I know it's risky, and I do not want any problem after. But on the other hand, I like to do this cast iron and silver work very much. And since I'm doing this, it's easy, because I do this, I offer it, some people like it, and they buy it, and then it's finished. I never, I hear from the clients because they want another piece of my work, but I've never heard someone had trouble using my cast iron tools. Okay, I did not have real trouble with these public works too, but also I'm working alone in my own studio I had, it's not because of the academy, it's easy to find people to help me. They're all good trained in metal craft, and I could do this public work. Okay, if someone comes to me and he want to do me something, I will do it, but I'm not looking for it anymore.
Excuse me, it's very exciting to watch this. Your anvil, is that stainless steel or the anvil where you hammer the...
No, it's steel.
It's steel, yeah. Okay. It's not iron. That's interesting. Why steel is stronger than iron or why is...
The structure of the material is different. Because the iron, the cast iron, is, I would say, the simplest kind of iron you can form or you can produce objects. But, iron can break if it is, there's mechanical power gets to the iron. And steel, they put different other metals, mixture of metals with steel and... to make it to become more solid, and it is used for other technical works or technical details.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Over here.
Okay.
Thank you. I want to return to the object that you won your first award, the grill with the stands, yeah. And you talked about being inspired by. A particular similar ancient stand, Turkish stand, in museums. Yeah. Could you talk about the original object that inspired you? What materials was it made out of?
Oh, okay, it's a long time I found it, but I think it was forged of steel. It was forged steel.
I just have one technical question. On one of your earlier cast iron pot, you attached steel handles.
Yes.
And you said you soldered them, but how did you solder from the steel to the cast iron? Was it brazed? I always have trouble attaching to cast iron. Like, I work with old cast iron stoves, and if there's a crack, it's very, very difficult to repair.
Excuse moment. Do you know what did you ask? Braze? Brazing. Yes, it's I did it with braze.
It's braze.
Yeah, it's braze.
Okay.
But it's also because I drill into the iron before.
Right.
It goes 1 centimeter into the iron, and so it braze it, and. Sorry.
Okay.
I work with braze, so it will be solid.
Yeah, I repair like antique stoves, cast iron stoves, you know, from the 1800s. Yeah. And normally they're very, very difficult if they crack because the cast iron is brittle.
The point is you have only one chance to braze it because if you braze and it does not work the first time,
right.
There will be oxidations
okay.
Inside and you will never get them out. You have no chance to get the oxidation out, and you cannot go on brazing again.
Oh, interesting. Thank
because
you.
There will be pores. There will all the time be pores.
Yeah, I could. Thank you.
Yeah, on the model that you showed the whole process with, where you went from making the model of copper and then taking it to the foundry, you covered it with what looked like Bondo or polyester kind of.
Yes.
What's the purpose of doing that within the sand mold?
No, this has no special purpose for doing the sand mold. It's only for my purpose because I like. For me, it is easy to work with this material because it is easy to grind, and I can easy
So you're finishing the model by using the polyester as a kind of a finishing coat.
Yes.
Okay.
But it has no special effect for the mating in the farm.
Yeah, I get it now. Yeah. All right, thank you.
Last question.
Thank you very much. It's beautiful. I was curious on the fondue pot that you showed. How heavy is that, and how long does it take to heat that with an alcohol flame?
Okay, the big fondue pot, you must heat the oil or cheese, whatever you use, on a regular stove, and then fill it into the iron pot. And this alcohol heater, it keeps it hot on the table. And also it has enough heat, because if you use an oil fondue, or use oil for fondue, you need a lot of heat, because the oil must broiling. Yeah, but the power of this heater is big enough. But if you could heat it up only with this heater, but it would last too much time. The pot, I think, 6 to 7 kilograms. Okay, German people are very special, because the whole German society must have problems with this and problems with the leg, because all the time I show the objects at an exhibition or a fair, every second people, oh, this and that. But I have never made this experience in the United States. Here the people are coming, oh, it's heavy, it's great. Yeah, this, and so for this I like to come to the States with my objects, because this must be the right place. Yeah. Yeah, also, okay, but also the young people, forget it. Okay. Thank you very much for paying attention.
Berthold.
Okay. Karin?
Berthold. Berthold. We could go on all night. Berthold, I want to thank you so much for such a splendid and eloquent presentation. To present a lecture like this in your own language is challenging, but to do it in a second language was absolutely superb. And we know how hard you work for it, and I can't tell you how much we appreciate it. So we could.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yes. Yeah. And I also want to commend you for your beautiful, stunning, functional objects. They really are. They're just utterly magnificent. And it was fascinating to be able to see how they were made. So thank you so much. I also want to remind you all that you can see actual samples of Berthold's cookware in the window, particularly the fondue pot. It's in our window. And also, very importantly, I'd mentioned at the beginning of the talk that at E.R. Butler, which I think is in Prince Street in Soho, Berthold's work will be displayed, I think, for the next month. Is that correct? Yeah, and you're more than welcome, of course, to go down and visit it and see. I think there's quite a lot of work on display there. But back to tonight's lecture. So, Berthold, on occasions like this, we would like to make a presentation to you. And to do so is Victoria Dengel, our executive director.
And Berthold, I I echo Karen's comments, and what more can I say? Because she says it so right every time, as we all know. But you're everything we could ask for in an artisan lecture. It was just so wonderful, so beautiful, and you evoked, you know, the tradition, the metal making, the sensibilities, the devotion to your craft, and just the way you were inspired at an early age and you were born to do this. It's clear. And it really means so much that you came and shared this with us. And of course that you brought your wife, Elizabeth, who we got to meet yesterday and thoroughly enjoy as well. And it has meant so much to us that you have come to share your knowledge and really put it down for life. You know, Berthold came here yesterday and he was saying what it meant to look back and examine his life's work. And while it was a very difficult act, he was so glad that he did it, because you've left it for all of us to have forever. And so thank you for that. Thank you, Berthold. So on behalf of the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen, founded 1785, whose motto was adopted at our first meeting with those 22 artisans in 1785, and conveniently the motto of the society has never been more right tonight. It's, by hammer and hand, all arts do stand. Could we ask for anything more? So we express our gratitude to Berthold Hoffman, atelier metalworker and silversmith, for his participation in the General Society Artisan Lecture Series. So thank you, Berthold.
Thank you very much.
Yes. And Berthold, because you've expressed a love for the United States, we're grateful, and the General Society, so we've made you and Elizabeth lifetime members of our library. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. And finally, you may have seen me disappear briefly in the Q&A, because I had to run and get you a T-shirt, because, well, isn't this will work so well in your studio? By hammer and hand, all arts do stand.